All right, so for this game, we have what is just kind of a textbook in and out game. There's going to be a bunch of these paintings, and specifically five of them are going to be selected. So I guess we'll just set up accordingly. It's quite literally just in and out, and we know that we have five spaces on the inside, which since there are eight in total, that means that we are going to have three spaces on the outside. From there, we have, I guess, let's start with the elements. We have F, G, H, I, and then we've got Q, R, S, and V, and the rules. So the first rule tells us that if we have, I guess, either or both, but really, I mean, that just means if we have at least one of G or H, then we're going to have an F. So if, now you'll notice that there's a lot of conditional rules in this game, so there's a good chance that they're all going to end up linking up. So what I'll do is I'll split this rule out and basically say that if we have a G or an H, then we're going to have an F. And then contrapose, this essentially tells us that if we don't have an F, then we will not have a G and we will not have an H. Next, second rule, if we have a V, then we'll have to have both Q and R. Now you'll notice that we don't really have any Vs, Qs, or Rs on the board here. So you know what? I'm going to let this rule slide for just a moment to see if I can connect things into the other rules. So the third rule we can work with, if we have an H, then we have neither Q nor I. So this guy right here, if there is an H, then we cannot have a Q and we cannot have an I. So contrapose, we essentially get that if we have a Q or if we have an I, then we can't possibly have an H. Now, you'll notice that we essentially have exclusive relationships created here, right? So between H and Q, right, we can't have them both in, so at least one has to be out. And the same thing applies to H and I. They can't both be in, so at least one of them is going to have to be out. So what we can do is we can reserve a space on the outside. In fact, we can combine the two to say that on the outside, at the very least, we're going to have either an H or both Q and I. So the fact that we only have three spaces on the outside and we can kind of reserve at least a space there, that is useful. Next, so let's go back to the second rule. Since we have a Q on the board, we can kind of link this in. So if we have a V, then we're supposed to have both Q and R. So a V is going to lead us into this Q over here, and we'll have an R as well. So contraposed, we can say that if we don't have a Q, then we cannot have a V. And likewise, if we don't have an R, then we also cannot have a V. Next, so the fourth rule. Now we're told that if we have both G and S, then we can't have I. Now this one's a bit of a rougher rule to incorporate into this because it's worth noting that this we can't separate this rule out, right? Because it's not that G or S independently would trigger something, right? This is, we have to keep those guys together. It's that the two of them together would then kick out the I. That said though, we can actually simplify this rule a little bit because when you're saying that if you have both G and S in, then I is gonna have to be out, really all you're saying here is that as far as those three elements are concerned, G, S, and I, you're just gonna have to have one of them out. They can't all three combined. You can't have all of them on the inside. So just to kind of clean this up a little bit, I'll do that. I'll just simply rewrite this as between G, S, and I, we have to have a minimum of one out. Now you'll notice that they could potentially all perhaps be out. It's not that only one of them is out, but at least one of them will definitely have to be on the outside. In fact, we could even kind of reserve another placeholder here. We can say that on the outside, we have to have at least one of G, S, or I. It's not as good as having kind of a placeholder pair, but it's still something. Next, lastly, if we have an F, then we have to have exactly one of S or V. And again, this one's a bit of a rougher rule because for this rule, we can't separate this out. It's not that if we have an F, then we'll have to have an S necessarily. That doesn't work on its own. And if you have an F, it's not like you'll have to have V. We don't know which way that's going to go. So we kind of have to keep this rule together. We can't combine things here. And this is going to get a little bit messy because we already have an F and there's a lot of stuff going on there. But we can readjust this a little bit. Let's move the R. In fact, let's move the R down here. If we don't have an R, then we can't have a V. And let's also get the G out of the way. If you don't have F, then you won't have a G. So it's a little bit cleaner. And now we can say, so if we trigger this guy, if we trigger the F, then we'll have to have exactly one. So one or the other, but not both. And we have to keep that rule together. So what I'll do is I'll say something like, if there's an F, then I'll have to have an S or a V. And then I'll also kind of clarify not both for the sake of noticing it. Now, in terms of contraposing this actually also, there's a bit more to it than that. So we can contrapose this by saying that if we don't have an S and we don't have a V, then we cannot, put it in the wrong place. If we don't have an S and we don't have a V, then we cannot have an F. But there's a bit more to it than that. Because this rule tells us that it's also not both, we would trigger the contrapositive also by having both. Because if we have both S and V, then it's also impossible to have an F, because an F would have dictated that we only have one of them. So we can add another rule here that says that if you happen to have both S and V, you will also have to get rid of F. Either one of these would trigger F's removal. Now, from there, there's a whole bunch of stuff going on here, so it's a bit of a mess. But you know what? We have everything linked in, a lot of the stuff linked in together, so that's kind of nice. Let's just go straight into the questions. So the first question is, as usual, our exclusion question. So we do it by the original set of rules. So first rule, if we have a G or an H, then we have to have an F. So let's see if anything violates that. Answer choice A has a G but with an F, so we're good. B already has an F, we're fine. C has an F, we're fine. Now D, you'll notice there's a G there, but there's no F. So that gets rid of answer choice D. And E already has an F, so we're good. Next, if we have a V, then we're supposed to have Q and R as well. So let's take a look. Answer choice A and B don't seem to have a V. C has a V, and we're supposed to have Q and R, which we do, so we're good. D has a V, but there's no Q, so we can get... Oh, but we've already gotten rid of D. That's no fun. E has a V, but there's no Q, there's no R, so we can get rid of answer choice E. Next, if we have an H, then we're supposed to kick out both Q and I. So answer choice A doesn't have an H, B doesn't have an H, C has an H, and we're supposed to get rid of Q, but we didn't, so answer choice C is out, and D and E are already gone. Next, if we have both G and S, then we're supposed to get rid of I. So between A and B, look at that, we have all three. We have G and S, but there's also an I, which is not cool, so we can get rid of A, and B doesn't have both G and S, so we're good. So the best answer to question number 13 is B. Next, let's take a look. Let's grab, it looks like they're all local, so we'll just do these in order. Question number 14. If I is not selected, let's play this out. If I is out, what does that effectively tell us? Actually, it doesn't look like it tells us much, does it? Because if I is out, that's kind of a dead end. This doesn't trigger anything further. That pretty much takes care of both of our placeholder sets as well, doesn't it? So that's kind of a mess. So in that sense, it doesn't seem like we can do much here, can we? You know what? Let's see. Maybe we have enough to work with. Maybe we can just run through the answer choices. The question itself asks, each of the following pairs could be among the selected paintings except. So we're looking for two that cannot both be in. Answer choice A, could we have Q and R? Now, if we have a Q, we'll just have to kick out the H, which seems okay. And if we have an R, then nothing really happens. So I think that seems fine. There doesn't seem to be any consequence. Answer choice B, could we have both S and G? Well, If we have S and G, first of all, these two would kick out the I, but I is already out, so that's not a problem. And otherwise, okay, so to be fair, if we have a G, we'll have to trigger F. And we did say that we already have an S, which means we would have to get rid of V because we can't have both. But that seems fine still, right? You could have, yeah, V out and then G and S would both be in. So that seems okay. Answer choice C, can we have V and G? Well, if we have a V, then we'll have to get rid of Q. Sorry, we'll have to have Q and get rid of H, which is fine. And then if we have G, then I guess if V is there, then we'll have to get rid of S. But that's still okay. That seems fine. Answer choice E, can we have both S and V? Well, if we have both S and V, that means that we're triggering this thing right here. So if they're both in, then we're going to have to get rid of F. Oh, there we go. That's a problem. So if we trigger S and V, you'll notice that we would have to kick out F, G, and H. That's three people out. But we've already reserved one space on the outside for I, as per the question, which means we only have two more spaces left. So there's no way to have both S and V in. Best answer here is answer choice D. For the record, answer choice E, just in case. R and G, can we have both of those guys? Well, maybe. I mean, if we have a G, then again, we'll have to have F, and you'll have to get rid of one of these two. And R doesn't really do anything for us, so that seems okay as well. Either way, best answer definitely is D. Next, question 15. If both F and H are selected. So if we have H and F, let's play this out. So first of all, it does mean that we're triggering this and actually all of this as well. There's quite a lot going on. So let's start with the H. H triggers the F, which we already have, but it also kicks out the Q. It also kicks out the I, and it also kicks out the V. Ooh, that's pretty good. Wait a minute, we can take a step further here, because you'll notice that, I guess once we nailed on the extension, on the outside, we have to really either have H or all three of QIV. So our placeholder here, we could extend this out. We could say that this is actually either H or all three of Q, I, and V who are going to have to be out, which is what happened here. But anyways, let's keep going. So anything else we can do? Well, since we kicked out QIV, that does mean that everybody else now has to go in. So I suppose that means R is in, S is in, and then who's? Oh, G would also have to be in. So that's pretty good. Let's see what we can do. The question itself asks, which of the following pairs must be two of the selected ones? Let's just simplify this. We know Q, I, and V all have to be out, so they cannot be among those that are selected. So you can cross off anything with a Q, an I, or a V, which gets rid of A, B, C, and E. The best answer here then is answer choice D. All right, next, question number 16. Let's take a look. We've got, if both Q and V are selected for the show, well, I guess let's play that out. If we have both Q and V selected, what does that tell us? Well, first of all, we know that Q kicks out H, which is kind of nice, so we can get rid of H. And V, we also know that V, I mean, obviously triggers Q, but also it brings in R as well. So we know that R would also have to be in as well. At this stage, can we do anything else? And it doesn't seem like we could, right? I mean, we could arguably still kick out both F and G. That's still potentially viable. I mean, V is in, but that doesn't necessarily trigger one of these rules. So yeah, this feels like a bit of a dead end. Let's take a look at the question. Maybe we can do with what we have. So the question is, which of the following could be two of the paintings? Answer choice A, could we have both S and H in? And well, no, obviously not, because H we know is already out. So answer choice A gets disqualified. Next, could we have S and I both in? Now, if we have S and I, now S would effectively allow us to trigger this guy. We would have S and V, which to be fair would kick out F and G, but we can make that work. I mean, we have the room for F and G to be out. And if I was in, that would just kick out the H, which is also kind of okay. So this seems pretty good. Let's quickly hold on to B. Let's run the other ones. Answer choice C. Could we have S and F both in? And no, based on what we in fact just kind of said, if we trigger the S, then we'll have both S and V because V is already in. But if we have S and V, then we'll have to get rid of F. So we couldn't have S and F. Next, could we have G and I? Well, if G and I were both in, well, no, because then G would trigger F, and we know that we wouldn't have room if G and I are already there. They're going to take up the last two positions. Answer choice E, could we have G and H? Well, no, H is already out, so that's not going to work. So the best answer to question number 16 then is answer choice B. Lastly, question 17. If Q is not selected, well, once again, let's play this out. If Q happens to be out, what does that tell us? Well, first of all, if Q is out, then V is definitely out, so that's a nice start. Anything else we can do with that? Well, I suppose we can bring down the placeholder, right? Because we know that between G, S, I, one of those three is going to have to be out. So essentially we have that, one of these three, which now means, again, we're full on the outside. Everybody else has to go in, which would include F, it would include H, Q, R has to be in as well. And I guess the other two of GSI. So let's see what we can do with this. So if F is in, then we're supposed to have one of S or V, but V is out. So it's going to have to be S who is going to be in. So I guess S, this can't be. It's either G or I on the outside. Anything else we can do with this? If we have an S, no, I suppose at this stage we're still... Oh, actually, wait a minute. Yeah, there it is. If we have an H, then we're supposed to kick out the I. So... I is going to be the one who is out. So it's not, again, it's not GS or I. It's definitely going to be the I who is out and the G who's going to be in. So to the question, which of the following pairs must be two of the selected ones? Again, let's just kind of go the other way. Q, V, I are all out. So we can cross anything with a Q, V, or an I. So A is out, C is out, and D and E are all out. So the best answer to question 17 is B, R and S. Yeah, they are definitely going to have to be in.